So I will let him introduce himself and explain all that.
Good morning, everybody. So you voted, and cornrows won, so here they are. And as I said, I will do the announcements. So welcome to all who are joining us today here in the sanctuary and those who are joining us from home, either via the internet or on the radio. We are blessed to be worshiping together. Many of you desire to support the Lord's work here at Zion and Brainerd through your tithes and offerings. The elders are still not comfortable passing the offering plate down the pews, so offerings are received either on your way in or on your way out of service. They can also be mailed or dropped off at the church office. They can also be sent online at zionbrainerd.org by clicking the box that says Zion's Online Giving, or by using the Give Plus app on your smartphone. If you are listening to the worship service broadcast on Cash 95.9 in the park in the Brainerd Lakes area, or participate online either live stream or recorded on YouTube or Facebook, and would like to receive a printed bulletin to participate in the service, there are a few ways this could be made possible. The bulletins are available on the church's website. You can contact the church office so that we can arrange to mail you a bulletin, or you can pick up one from the white bulletin mailbox in the parking lot that has a sign on it that says bulletins. Effective immediately, Zion will return to its pre-pandemic procedures. The elders will be working out the details for this transition at their next meeting. So VBS will be held this week, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday from 5:30 to 8. Please sign your kids, your grandkids, your neighbor's kids up for this fun event. More information can be found on the church's website or Facebook. If you would like to donate snacks, there was a sign-up sheet in the lounge. There is not a sign-up sheet anymore because today's the day to drop those off. Our annual outdoor worship service and church picnic at Lum Park is scheduled for next Sunday, July 11th at 10:30. This will be a potluck event, so bring a dish to share, meat to grill, beverage, dinnerware, and something to sit on. If the weather is bad, we will move back to the church for the service. We're looking forward to our 21st annual polka service with Chuck and Thiel and the Jolly Ramblers to be held July 17th at 5:30 p.m. A meal, brats, beans, and slaw, and more music will follow the service. Please come join us for the fun event. There will be no Sunday school this week or next Sunday. We are holding adult Bible class at 9:15. Stick around and vote on a name for the new meeting room. And finally, donuts and coffee are available today in the newly remodeled area following the service. Come share in fellowship and maybe stay for the Lost Books Bible class. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Yep. If you didn't recognize, that's Jonathan Bailey, our DCE. Just thought I'd clarify. Happy 4th of July, Pastor Steve. It's great for us to be able to be here together, to worship together. Our risen Lord, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, we are blessed to be here. Just a couple of other announcements. The Vacation Bible School, as Jonathan said, starts this Tuesday. This Tuesday, we also have a funeral here. Donna Woolery's funeral is here on Tuesday. And so we will be decorating for Vacation Bible School quickly after the funeral. So if anybody's available Saturday, Tuesday afternoon, to help put stuff together. I'm sure they would love to have any extra hands they could get to help set stuff up for Vacation Bible School. The other thing is, I was parasailing on vacation this last week and I landed in a tree. No, not really. I did something to my back and it hurts really bad. I'm on medication. So hopefully I'll stay awake through the whole service. So if I slur a little bit, just because of the medication, there's nothing else going on. But yeah, I am sore. So please pray for me and my back to heal quickly. We begin our service this 4th of July by singing our opening hymn, "Before You, Lord, We Bow."
Thank you. protected by your care. This bright day, for this fair land, gifts of your hand, our thanks we pay. May every mountain height, each vale and forest green, shine in your word's pure light and its rich fields be seen. May every tongue be tuned to praise and joined to raise a grateful song. Earth, hear your Maker's voice, your great Redeemer on. Believe, obey, rejoice, and worship Him. Cast down your pride, your sin before, and bow before the crucified. And when in power He comes, oh, may our native land from all its rending tombs send forth a glorious band. A countless throng with joy to sing to heaven's high King salvation song.
Please stand. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Therefore, let anyone who thinks that he stands take heed, lest he fall. No temptation has overtaken you that is not common to man.
God is faithful, and He will not let you be tempted beyond your ability. But with the temptation, He will also provide the way of escape, that you may be able to endure it.
For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin.
Let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace, that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in time of need.
Most merciful God, we confess in your pride,
arrogance, and boasting. Forgive us all our sins in our thoughts, words, and works for the sake of Jesus, who made Himself nothing, taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, He humbled Himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, for Jesus' sake, as a called and ordained servant of Christ. I forgive you all your sins of thoughts, words, and works. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
And I am sure of this, that He who began a good work in you
will bring it to completion at the day of Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Let us pray. Gracious and ever-loving God, we thank and praise you for the freedom we have in you, and also the freedom we celebrate today in our nation. As your grace has been sufficient for your people throughout all time, grant that it be sufficient for us as well, for your power is made perfect in our weakness.
Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated.
The Old Testament reading this morning comes from Isaiah, the 61st chapter. The Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor. He has sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, and the opening of the prison to those who are bound, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all who mourn, to grant to those who mourn in Zion, to give them a beautiful headdress instead of ashes, the oil of gladness instead of mourning, the garment of praise instead of a faint spirit, that they may be called the oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. They shall build up the ancient ruins. They shall raise up the former devastations. They shall repair the ruined cities, the devastations of many generations. Strangers shall stand and tend your flocks. Foreigners shall be your plowmen and your vine dressers. But you shall be called the priests of the Lord. They shall speak of you as the ministers of our God. You shall eat the wealth of the nations, and in their glory you shall boast. Instead of your shame, there shall be a double portion. Instead of dishonor, they shall rejoice in their lot. Therefore, in their land, they shall possess a double portion. They shall have everlasting joy. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The epistle is found in 2 Corinthians, the 12th chapter, verses 1 through 10. I must go on boasting. Though there is nothing to be gained by it, I will go on to visions and revelations of the Lord. I know a man in Christ 14 years ago was caught up in the third heaven, whether in the body or out of the body, I do not know. God knows. And I know that this man was caught up into paradise, whether in the body or out of the body. I do not know. God knows. And he heard things that cannot be told, which man may not utter. On behalf of this man, I will boast, but on my own behalf, I will not boast, except in my weakness. Though if I should wish to boast, I would not be a fool, for I would be speaking the truth. But I refrain from it, so that no one may think more of me than he sees in me or hears from me. So to keep me from being too elated by the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from being too elated. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me. But he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly in my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with my weaknesses, with insults and hardships and persecutions and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong." This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Please stand out of respect to the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke, the 22nd chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
A dispute also arose among the disciples as to which of them was to be regarded as the greatest. And Jesus said to them, "The kings of the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors. But not so with you. Rather, let the greatest among you become as the youngest, and the leader as one who serves. For who is the greater, the one who reclines at table or one who serves? Is it not the one who reclines at table? But I am among you as the one who serves. You are those who have stayed with me in my trials, and I assign to you, as my Father assigns to me, a kingdom, that you may eat and drink at my table in my kingdom and sit on thrones judging the 12 tribes of Israel. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated as we sing our sermon song, Alleluia, Sing to Jesus.
Is the sound.
Sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. I'm sore. I don't know what I did. I woke up Tuesday morning with this pain in my back, and by the time Wednesday afternoon happened, I was at the immediate care here in town, and they gave me some medications because my muscles in my back and over my shoulder and everything were all seizing up. I was in a lot of pain then. And after Thursday, Friday, Saturday, 3.5 days of medication, I can say it's better-ish. It still hurts a lot. There's certain movements that I do that I know that I shouldn't do, like turn my head certain directions. I'm sore. I'm pretty sure it's a pinched nerve or a bulging disc or something fun like that, so I'll find myself back at the doctor's tomorrow, I'm sure. But as we read our epistle lesson from 2 Corinthians chapter 12, St. Paul writes this: "So to keep me from being too elated by the surpassing greatness of the revelations, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to harass me, to keep me from being too elated. 3 times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me." Let me tell you, it's been more than 3 times that I have pleaded with the Lord that this pain should leave me. And you know what he keeps saying? The same thing he said to St. Paul: "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong." So let me tell you, I'm weak today. Not a whole lot of sleep. I'm weak today. The medications that I take say may cause drowsiness. They caused drowsiness, but not sleep. I'm weak because I'm tired. I'm weak because I hurt. I am weak. Anybody else feeling lousy today? Anybody else have some aches and pains? Is it because of maybe the hot temperature we're supposed to be getting today? What are they saying, upper 90s? Yay, 4th of July. What a great time for us to be celebrating indoors in the air conditioning, and pray for those poor souls who have to go outside and light the fireworks, because it's going to be hot for them around all those flames and sparks. Anybody else feel like me? Physically sore, tired, frustrated? I would guess that all of us, if not right now, at times understand those feelings. Those feelings of being sore and tired, and maybe even overwhelmed by those things. It might not be a physical pain. It could be a spiritual pain. It could be an emotional pain. It could be the loss of a loved one. It could be the breaking down of a relationship between you and somebody else. But we all, like Paul, have those times in which we are weak. And those times in which we go to God, and it seems as if his answer is silence. And we pray and we pray and we pray and we seem to come up with one understanding that the Lord is simply ignoring me right now. Or maybe that God's really busy. I mean, look at all this stuff going on in the Middle East. There's a bunch of stuff for him to be worried about. My sore back? Not so important. Not high on his priority list. If you've ever thought that, then Satan is definitely alive and well and active in our lives, telling us those things. You don't matter to God that much. He's got bigger things going on. Your worries, your struggles, your pains are not important to God. That's what Satan says over and over again. So why do you keep praying then? If God doesn't really care, then why should you pray? Why should you go to the Lord and continue to pray if he is simply going to ignore you? What does Paul say? He says this, "But he, the Lord, said to me, 'My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness.'" Could you imagine? I would like to imagine, but could you imagine that after Tuesday when I woke up with a little twinge in my back, if I would have done something right away, gone to the doctor, taken some ibuprofen, done something, gone to a masseuse, had the knot worked out, done something, and then afterwards I would be able to say, look at what I did. I could have had a really sore back, but look at how much I did. Look at how well I took care of that situation. Where's God in my seeing of that? Am I giving any credit to God for the fact that he created the people who created ibuprofen? Would I give God the glory that the person who had taken the masseuse classes, he had given them their talent? Or did I just simply go, it's all better. Don't have to worry about it. And God doesn't enter the picture. It's me taking care of my situation. I've got this. I've got it all under control. Sometimes God allows us to continue in our weaknesses so that we would go to him continually, that we would be reminded that he is with us in the midst of our struggles, that he is there. And when he doesn't answer our prayers the way that we would expect him, when he says those words, as he says to Paul, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness," then it's not about me. Then it's not about me having the strength. It's about God having the strength to get me up, to help me shower, to make sure I put on the right clothes, to drive here, to stand up in front of you, not on my own strength. Because let me tell you, if given the choice, be in church this morning or be laying in bed with an ice pack on my back, you know where I would be? Home. In bed, with an ice pack on my back and then a heating pad on my back, barking orders at my wife, go get me some water, go get me a cup of coffee, come massage my back. If it was all about me being in control, if it was all about me being able to do what I, sinful me, wanted to do, that's where I would be. But God woke me up this morning before my alarm. God allowed me this morning to get ready. God allowed me to make it here. God allowed me to have the opportunity to talk about weakness in the midst of my own weakness. God is amazing. I could have picked this Bible reading out, maybe this morning, to put in the bulletin and be able to go, well, you know, this is what we should talk about this morning. This bulletin was prepared 3 weeks ago. The readings were chosen years ago, as all most of our Sunday morning readings are on a system called the pericope system, which is simply the system that a lot of churches use so that all of the readings at many different congregations, many different denominations have the same readings. So that this service today would have this reading today, so I could talk about my weakness today, is not a me thing. I didn't put that there. God in his wisdom put it there. God in his wisdom allowed me to be in pain today. And I pray, Lord, that the pain would go away quickly. How about us in our lives? In those times when we are weak, in those times when we are tired and frustrated and sore and simply want to close the door and be left alone, is God there? Definitely. Has God ever left us? No. Does God always answer our prayers with a yes? No. But he answers it this way: my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. My power is made perfect in weakness. So when people look at me, they don't see me, strong me, doing it all myself, but they see God using wimpy me, slow me, overweight me, that God would use even me. God wants to use even you. God has a purpose and a plan for each and every one of us. God has a desire for each of us to follow him. I had a great opportunity last Sunday. As many of you know, Stafford Thompson, who currently is still a member of our congregation until we officially send the letter to his new congregation, Hope Lutheran Church in Munger, Minnesota. Last Sunday, I had the opportunity to preach at Stafford's ordination and installation. What a blessing it was to be there in that small congregation with a sanctuary full. People excited about the new things to come, that God is going to do something new there in that place. And not that the things that had been done before were old things and needed to stop, but all of those things had to be put in place to be getting that congregation ready for Stafford to be there to be their pastor. And God then will use Stafford and Emma to do his work there in that place. The places where each of us have been planted by God are special. God has put each of us into our families, into our places of employment, into those neighborhoods, into those organizations that we are a part of. God has placed us for what purpose? To bring his grace. To allow others to see in us weakness. Which sounds really silly here on the 4th of July when we celebrate our independence, our strength as a nation, our ability to stand bold, which is wonderful. But at the same time, if we simply stand bold without Jesus, the reality is we're weak. We don't have the strength, the true strength that we could have when we stand in front of God, with God behind us, Lord, we got this. We are the greatest nation on the face of the earth. I've heard more than once this week. The greatest nation in the history of the world, I've heard this week from different newscasters in preparation for the 4th of July. But not many of them ended anything with, so help me God, by the grace of God. Through God's power, we have become. No. It's all about us taking credit for us being the greatest because we are the greatest. And brothers and sisters, let me tell you, we are not the greatest. God is the greatest. And God, in his love, sent Jesus to do what? To become a servant. When Jesus' disciples asked him, who is the greatest in your kingdom? Hoping that Jesus was going to say, well, obviously it's Peter, and it's James, and it's John. Those three, since they're closer to me, those would be the greatest. And you other nine, well, you're good, but, you know, you're not the greatest. And between the three of these, I'm going to go with Peter. Peter is the greatest, just because, well, Peter's mentioned a lot more, right? So therefore, obviously, he must be the greatest. What did Jesus say? He said this, the kings and the Gentiles exercise lordship over them, and those in authority over them are called benefactors, but not so with you. Rather, let the greatest among you become the youngest, and the leader as one who serves. For who is greater, one who reclines at the table or the one who serves? Is it not the one who reclines at the table? But these words. But I, Jesus says, I am among you as one who serves. God Almighty took himself from his heavenly throne and placed himself here to become the servant of all. God Almighty, who came from all glory in heaven, God came down to earth, put on human flesh, lived a perfect life in the midst of people like us, or people worse than us. You know, like Romans and Greeks and those people that the Jews would have looked down on at Jesus' time. Those people. He came and lived among people like us. People who are selfish, people who are judgmental, people who try and put ourselves higher on the pedestal, people like us who are sinners. Jesus, God, came down from heaven, put on human flesh, put himself underneath everyone to serve everyone as a servant. He suffered and died for everyone. Not because they were better than he was, because he was God. He is God and he is man. And he came to serve. He put on weakness. The God who created all things put on weakness so that we would receive the gift of forgiveness, the gift of eternal life, not because we've earned it, not because we deserve it, but because God in his love came and placed himself underneath all of us. Suffered and died for all of us, that we would receive such great gifts. God's love for us is immense. God's love for us is great, not because we deserve it, but because he, God, loves us, each and every one of us. So we're called then to become servants, to not look at ourselves as better than anyone else, to look at ourselves through the eyes that God sees us as sinners for whom his son died, and for us to look at others with those same eyes, those same eyes that see that Jesus came and suffered even for our enemies, even for those people we don't get along with, even for those nations around the world who are out to get us, even for those neighbors who drive us nuts because they snowblow at 2:30 in the morning. God wants us to love and to live as he has done, so that we, like Paul, could boldly say, "For when I am weak, then I am strong. When I am weak, then Jesus is glorified. When I step back from being the most important thing and allow God to be seen and glorified, then my strength is in him and in him alone. And when that's the case, I cannot be any stronger. There's nothing I can do to be stronger than allow God to be God, and for me to see my weaknesses as a way to share God with those who are just like me, sore, tired, frustrated." Please pray with me. Lord God, Heavenly Father, we thank and praise you for all that you have done for us, especially for sending your son Jesus to be our Savior. Lord, we pray that you would give us strength to face each day of our lives. Help us, Lord, to see in our times of weakness you, that through our weakness we are strong. Through our weakness, Lord, you are more evident in our lives. So, Lord, let us be glad and rejoice in those times, because when we are truly weak, then, Lord, we get out of the way and we allow you to be strong. Give us courage, Lord, to see ourselves as we truly are. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We continue on page 8 of our worship folder with the Nicene Creed. I invite you all to stand. I believe in one God, the Father
Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshiped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole people of God and for all people according to their needs. Almighty and most holy God, we thank and praise you for all you provide us freely by your grace. We are especially thankful for the freedom we enjoy and celebrate today as we gather to worship you, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
We pray for the leaders of our nation, state, and community, for President Biden, Governor Walz, and all elected and appointed officials. We acknowledge that you have placed them in these positions to govern us and all people of this land. Grant them wisdom to lead them to make decisions that are in line with your will for all people. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Amid the thorns of this life, we lean on your grace, knowing that it is sufficient for us in our weakness. Your strength shines through. We ask for your grace and healing for those who grieve, especially for Stephen Juracek at the passing of his mother, Joyce, for the family of Juanita Gaken, for the family of Donna Woolery, for Brian Lemieux and his family at the passing of his mother this past week. We also ask for your grace and healing for those who struggle in body, mind, and spirit, especially Jay, Eve, Earl, Eileen, Taya, Ev, Barb, Betty, Lil, Patty, Mason, Phyllis, Mary, Bob, Allie, Sharon, Donna, Lorraine, Nancy, Connie, Richard, Barb, Ira, KJ, Kimberly, Dale, Deb, Ron, Jana, Jim, Scott, Lana, David, and Sherry, and all others that we hold in our hearts. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We celebrate with all who celebrate birthdays and anniversaries, Lord. We pray that you would be with Lori, Walt, Katie, Beckett, Isaac, Alexander, Ellie, Ashley, Isabel, Jerry, Tyler, and Krista as they celebrate birthdays. And for Mark and Tammy and Teresa and Dave as they celebrate their anniversaries, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We live in a nation and a community where we are thankful to have brothers and sisters in Christ, yet there are so many who have either disconnected from you and your church or who have never known you. Lead us to share your grace with those. Guide our conversations and grow our relationship with those who do not share the hope we have. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
No matter where life takes us, we know we are in your hands, so we confidently come before you as your children and placing these prayers and all our concerns into your gracious hands. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and singing.
Holy, 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 Lord God of Sabaoth, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed, blessed, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest.
Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and to be our Savior. With repentant joy, we receive the salvation accomplished for us by his all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers. Deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Hear us as we pray in his name and as he has taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
Please be seated. Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way also, after supper, he took the cup. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen.
At this time, I invite you to open the side that has the wafer on it. Take and eat the body of Christ given for you. And opening the other side, take and drink the blood of Christ shed for you for the forgiveness of all of your sins. Now may this body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and preserve you in true faith until life everlasting. Depart in his joy and his peace. Your sins are forgiven. Amen. Give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
His steadfast love endures forever.
We thank you, Lord, for you have again fed and nourished us on our way through this world to the one to come. Guide us in living out your grace until that day when we experience it in all of its fullness. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Amen. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
Amen. We sing our closing hymn, God Bless Our Native Land.
Shall our prayers arise to God.